is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You'd lay down your life. That I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me.
And it is amazing grace and divine wonderful love. And it's a good morning on this Wednesday morning. A little cloudy here, but certainly very nice outside. And it's good to be able to get together with all of you folks this morning. I pray you're having a great week, and God is blessing in some incredibly marvelous and wonderful ways. All right, let's put that up there this morning, and let's see who's on board. Carolyn was first up this morning. Good morning, Miss Carolyn. I really appreciate you, and I appreciate you stepping up for Saturday. You and Janice really, really do appreciate it. Thank you. And Miss Cynthia, Ryan, good morning to you. I pray that this week hasn't been too hectic for you, but it's good to have you here with us this morning. You're precious. There's my Miss Sherry. Good morning, dear family. It's good to be with all of you. And that comes from just north of me. I mean, true north. Just above my head here. Good morning, my dear. Buddy, Julia, God bless you. Good morning. It's a beautiful day in Atlanta. Hello to everyone, and hello to you, my very good friend. It's good to see you up there this morning. And Miss Sue, good morning to you and your big fluffy bunny. I'm glad he's up and awake and feeling well. And it's good to be here. And aren't we all grateful for all the King of Glory has done and continues to do? Amen and amen. And Miss Donna, good morning to you. You say good morning, buddy, and all my friends. Yes, and Alyssa and Kara and Cam and Cody and the whole crew, good morning to you. We have Mama and Granddaddy here, too. Well, good morning, Mama and Granddaddy. It's good to have you on board with us. You got a special family, but I don't think I'm telling you anything that you don't already know. They are just really wonderful folks. And is this Mama and Granddaddy on Mom's side or Dad's side that's with us today. So, but at any rate, it's good to have you. God bless. And Miss Terry, good morning to everyone. And we flash back to you that three times I love you as well. Let's see. Good morning, Miss Ruth Ann. It's good to see you here this morning. And Kenneth, if you're there with us this morning, we give you a shout out and say how do to you too. All right, let's go ahead and pray before we launch in this morning, because we're going to be just really getting back into this. I want this flow to be unbroken as we get started. Father, I thank you. I thank you for the glory and the blessing it is to be able to be here this morning to open up your word together with this precious family that's out there. Lord, I am always amazed at how far we stretch, knowing that we've stretched as far as Kenya and other places, but within the framework of our own nation, Lord, we go from coast to coast and border to border. God, you have blessed us in so many marvelous and spectacular ways. I thank you for what you're doing within the life of our family, our fellowship. And Lord, I just pray that you continue to work your grace and work your power, work your will through us. Lord, we just simply want to be servants yielded up to you. And I pray, Lord, that we come today with an understanding heart, with a hearing heart. We come with that Leb Shema, that we might sit with our ears pressed against the very lips of God, so that we hear that still small voice. And Lord, we are ready and eager to do that which you tell us to do. We love you, Father, and we come and ask you to feed our hungry souls today upon your word. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, as we get started, overviewing and moving right in from yesterday into today. Yesterday we were looking at that command to love and its very nature within faith. Of course, verses 13 and 15 give us this command, doesn't it? For you are called to freedom, brethren. Only do not turn your freedom into an opportunity for the flesh, but through love serve one another. It's interesting to me that Paul has spent all this time laying the foundation, laying the groundwork, refuting legalism, the Pharisees, that branch that was trying to lead them away from the grace of God and from faith alone in Christ alone, to come to a point that we get our first real command out of this word, which is simply this, that we don't take the opportunity of the flesh, but through love, serve one another. And then he says, for the whole law is fulfilled in one word. In the statement, you will love your neighbor as yourself. But if you bite and devour one another, take care that you are not consumed by one another. You see, the command to love in Galatians 5:13 is a command to have the kind of free and confident heart that by its very nature can do nothing else but love. I mean, that's a very, very heart and core. That's what it beats to do. You see, love is motivated by the joy of sharing the fullness that God has placed within us, that bubbles up and out of us. But the works of the flesh, Paul has already said, are motivated by the desire to fill emptiness within ourselves. That's why people use other people, because there's a lacking in their own heart and their own life. So they have to use things and use people to try and fill that void. But only Christ can fill it. And when he does, and we are filled to the full, there is nothing else that the heart can do except flow out in acts of love. The meaning of the flesh, of course, you know, in Galatians is not talking about this physical part of man, but it's talking about the soma, the inner man, that ego, if you wish, which fills a deep emptiness and uses every means imaginable within its power to fill its emptiness. If a person is religious, then they'll use the law, or they'll use other rules and regulations, they'll use other things to fill it. They'll even use service to fill it, but even if they're operating in the flesh, all the service they do will never fill what they need. If a person is irreligious, then they're gonna turn to booze or drugs or sex or something else to fill that void. Good morning, Miss Helen. I see you got in here this morning. Looking forward to seeing you on Saturday, by the way. So good to have you here. So when Paul says in verse 13, don't use your freedom as an opportunity to the flesh, he means simply don't surrender your freedom that you have in the all-satisfying Christ to return to the unsatisfying desires of mere fleshly pleasures or self-exaltation. Instead, Paul says, use your freedom to love your neighbor as yourself. For the whole law, he says, just like Jesus did before, right? All of the law of the prophet hang on these two commands. Love God with all your heart, mind, soul, and strength. Love your neighbor as yourself. Well, this is what Paul says. For the whole law is fulfilled in one word, in the statement, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. Remember what I said yesterday. This command is not a command to love yourself. It is a command to take your natural, already existing love for self and make it as a measuring rod for the way that you love others. Use all the creativity and energy and perseverance to do good things for others that you would be doing those kind of things for yourself. Care about what happens to others as much as you care about what happens to your own life. Care about their needs the way you care about your own needs. Care about their future as much as you care about your own future. So this love motive will become the replacement for all the law of Moses. And why is this so essential for those in Christ? For one thing, any group made up of people who serve only themselves will eventually fall into conflict. And this is where we find that tragic alternative of love. For if we don't love like this, live like this, in verse 15, he tells us this is the alternative. But if you bite and devour one another, take care that you are not consumed by one another. When you find within a household the husband and the wife living strictly for themselves to get what they can and always looking to everybody else to fulfill the needs instead of being the one through whom God can meet the needs, you're going to end up finding that husband and wives consume, if you will, devour one another, and soon there's problems within that relationship. And that's true with any relationship. It's true in a church. It's true anywhere. If we don't live to love one another as ourselves, we just simply begin to bite and we're like, it gives us the idea of a pack of wild animals kind of nipping and biting at one another and going after the weakest or whatever until ultimately the whole pack is devoured. Any group of people who do not serve each other in love will ultimately destroy itself. Others will inescapably get in the way of our agenda and the ability to perfectly meet our desires. To always have things our way. We'll either have to turn aside from the needs of others or change just simply trampling those needs directly. What's it going to be? We going to continue to love one another because we are compelled to love? Or and get up and get out thinking, how can I meet someone's needs today? How can Christ fulfill himself through me? Inevitably, there are going to be these collisions that will lead to destruction of an entire group. You know, if everything is going fine and we're pushing, you know, my agenda, the moment something gets in the way of my agenda, the moment we hit that speed bump or we hit that detour sign, whatever it is, then the battle is on. That's why it can never be my agenda. It can never be your agenda. It has to be God's agenda, and we are all in submission to it, everyone. As James puts it, a life lived according to the worldly wisdom of serving self doesn't lead to human happiness. Instead, it leads to disorder, he says in James 3 and 16, and every vile practice. But then he goes on in that fourth chapter of James in verses 1 through 3, and he says, what is the source of quarrels and conflicts among you? Is not the source your pleasures that wage war in your members? You lust, do not have. You commit murder. You're envious, cannot obtain. So you fight and you quarrel. You do not have because you do not ask. And you ask and do not receive because you ask with the wrong motives so that you can spend it on your own pleasures. Look where the emphasis is in what James is talking about. Where's the source of quarrels among you? Is it not your pleasure? Is that not the source? I want my needs met. I need my stuff done. That wage war in your members. You lust. He says, you commit murder. You're envious. You fight. You quarrel. You don't have because you don't ask. You ask. You have the wrong motives. On and on. The big I, you, is at the center of all of that problem. So that's why Paul, that's why Jesus can say that we need to die to ourselves daily. Take up our cross and follow him. And he always worked from the Father's agenda, did he not? And he always sought nothing but the best for those that he encountered. They were refreshed from the overflow of his life. You say, well, yeah, but he was God. Yeah, but he was man. As Paul put it here, we end up devouring, consuming each other in order to try and get what we want. The alternative is to use our Christ-won freedom to set ourselves aside and serve each other in love. Not only does that lead to greater joy for all of us, it is living as Jesus would as we live free in him. Which is simply yielding ourselves and saying, you know, here we are, and allowing him to live the way he wants to live through our life. You know, and the more he lives through our life, the more full and we are, and the more every single desire and need that we have in life is met. The psalmist says, if you delight in the Lord, he'll give you the desires of your heart. Now, I used to think, you know, I think it was St. Francis that said, love God and do whatever you want to. I thought that was pretty flippant until I realized that if we truly love God, what we want to do is what he wants to do. If we truly delight in God, then the desires of our heart will be the desires of his heart. And they'll always be met. We see that the only activity which we can perform in freedom is love, which is why Paul emphasizes our calling in verse 13 when he says, for you are called to freedom, brethren, only do not turn your freedom to an opportunity of the flesh, but through love serve one another. This kind of love is not optional. It is commanded by Christ and relayed to us by Peter and Paul and John and James and so many others. But we come down here to the fact, as James has said, and as Paul has said, that there is a war that wages within us. This is why in verse 13, we have that. You are called to freedom, brethren. Only do not turn your freedom into an opportunity of flesh, but through love serve one another. This isn't an optional thing. It's a command by Christ and relayed to us, I think, through every book that you're going to read, you know, throughout the Bible, but especially here in the New Testament. Paul says to the Galatians again, for the whole law is fulfilled in one word, in the statement, you will love your neighbor as yourself. You say, Richard, you just keep pounding on that nail. Yeah, I do. You know why? Because it seems to me that God pounds on that nail an awful lot. He always comes back and strikes a hammer blow here. Because it is so hard for us to love like this. Because the human nature puts self, gets in the way and interrupts all of that. So we have to constantly be reminded and pressured, and not pressured, but pointed toward this whole thing called love. Love as he loved us. Love your neighbor as yourself. Now, that's radical. We looked at some of the radical aspects of that the other day. In other words, we're called in our freedom to desire and seek the happiness of others with the same zeal we seek our own happiness. But if you take this command seriously, it is so contrary to our natural inclinations that it seems utterly, utterly impossible. But that should get us up in the morning, and we should feel as much concern for other people's needs as we that is humanly possible, that we possibly can. As much as we look out for our own, and we understand it's utterly beyond our power. If this is the Christian life, caring for others as I care for myself, then it's hard, really, really hard, and I feel sometimes hopeless to ever live it out. But it's not. Paul gives us an answer to the discouragement that is found, and he gives us that answer in verses 16 through 18. Take a look at those verses. He says, "But I say to you, walk in the Spirit, and you will not carry out the desires of the flesh. For the flesh sets its desires against the Spirit, and the Spirit against the flesh. For these are in opposition to one another, so that you may not do the things that you please. But if you're led by the Spirit, you're not under the law." So the secret is truly learning to walk by the Spirit. There is this internal battle that rages within the heart of every one of us, all of you that are out there. And I'll bet every one of you at times feel like this tug of war is going on inside that's going to pull you apart. And there is. Because the flesh sets its desires against the Spirit and the Spirit against the flesh, and these two are contrary to one another. They're in opposition. So we can't always do the things that we please. But we're led by the Spirit. We're not under the law. If the Christian life looks too hard, we need to remember that we are not called to live it by ourselves. We must live it by the Spirit of God. The command to love is not a new legalistic burden laid on our back. It's what happens freely when we walk by the Spirit. People who try to love without relying on God's Spirit always wind up trying to fill their own emptiness rather than sharing their fullness. So, love ceases to be love. It starts to be manipulation. It starts to be just about anything, but really love. Loving this way is not only not easy for us, it's impossible. But the good news is that it's not primarily our work, but it's God. And we must simply learn to walk by the Spirit. Because only He can love this way. And He uses and desires to use us as vessels and instruments in which He can love the world through us. So I want to build some of this lesson around three questions. The what, the why, and the how. What is this walking by the Spirit? Why is it crucial to walk by the Spirit? And how very practically can we walk by the Spirit? Here's your first question. Put it down on your in your notebook, because we're going to ponder this for a minute. What is walking by the Spirit? There are two other images in this context which shed some light on the meaning of what it is to walk by the Spirit. The first is found in verse 18, "But if you are led by the Spirit, you are not under the law." If Paul had said, "If you follow the Spirit, you're not of the law," it would have been true. But in using the passive voice, "if you are led," he emphasizes the Spirit's work and not our own. Do you see the difference? You see, if he said, if you follow the Spirit, you're not of the law, that puts a little bit more of the responsibility on me, you know, to get out there and follow. And we are to follow, are we not? But he uses the passive voice. If you're led, gives us the idea of being you're blindfolded, if you will, and somebody taking our hand and leading us, or holding on to and leading us down a pathway. The Spirit is not a leader like a pace car at the Daytona 500. He's the leader like a locomotive on a train. We're coupled to him. We're not following at a distance. We're coupled to him. We don't follow in our own strength. That lead car is out there in front, and every other car is driving on their own energy. But we're being led by his power, and that's the difference. You see, there is no strength or power in any of the cars that are hooked up to the locomotive. The only power there is in a train is that which comes from the locomotive. Now, if it's a very long train, oftentimes you'll see two locomotives, one on the front and one in the back. But understand, there's no power in those cars in between that doesn't come from the locomotive, from the engine. So walk by the Spirit means to stay hooked up to the divine source of power and go wherever he leads. If the Christian life looks hard, we need to remember that we are not called to live it by ourselves. It is impossible. Now, the second image of our walk in the Spirit is given us in verses 22 and 23. Well, I'll give you a minute to put that down. We do not follow in our strength. We are led by his power. Verses 22 and 23 say, but the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Against such things there is no law. If our Christian walk is to be a walk of love and joy and peace and patience and kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control, then walk by the Spirit must mean bear the fruit of the Spirit. But again, the Spirit's work is what is emphasized here, and not ours. He bears the fruit. Perhaps Paul got this image from Christ and is recalling what has been taught to him and said to him, as Jesus did to the disciples before he was crucified in John 15, 4 and 5, when he says, abide in me and I in you. As a branch cannot bear fruit of itself unless it abides in the vine, so neither can you unless you abide in me. I am the vine, you're the branches. He who abides in me and I in him, he bears much fruit. For apart from me, you can do nothing. So, obviously, walking by the Spirit has to mean abiding in the vine. Keep yourself securely united, connected to the living Christ. Don't cut yourself off from the flow of the Spirit. So in answer to the first question, well, let me back up here for a minute. My grandfather used to grow grapes, used to make a little vino. And the back was an arbor with grapes, and you could watch Grandpa going out, and he'd tend those vines. And sometimes some of those branches that came off the vine would get gnarly. They'd get knots on them. And those knots would restrict, the flow of the life from the vine getting into the branches. So the fruit that it would bear would be, little bitty. It wouldn't be luscious. It wouldn't be large. So Grandpa would be out there very tenderly, very caringly, whittling away and cutting away at those knots, getting them down, opening up the flow so that the life of that vine could flow beautifully through the branches and bear, great bunches of grapes. And sometimes you and I, our life gets a little knotted up, doesn't it? It's kind of like I get knots in my neck or in my shoulder, and sometimes you got to put a little pressure on that knot to break it up. Well, he's the vine dresser. We're the branches. There's sometimes going to be some pruning, to this branch. There's going to be some chiseling away at the knots to open up the life. And that may not be a pleasant experience. None of us like to go through those trimming and pruning times in our life, do we? But my friends, they're absolutely necessary if the very life source of the Christian life is able to flow through us as freely as God intends it to. You know, so the answer to the first question, you know, keep yourself securely united to the living Christ. Keep buckled up. Keep connected to the engine. Don't cut yourself off from the flow of the Spirit. Allow Him to prune and trim as He needs to so that His life may flow more freely. So the first answer to the first question, what is walking by the Spirit? You know, we have to answer, it's being led by the Spirit, and it means bearing the fruit, not producing it. It doesn't say that we produce, we bear. He produces. We're simply the branch out there bearing that fruit. The work of the Spirit is emphasized, yet the command for us is to do something. Our wills are deeply involved. Remember, our innermost man is made up of our intellect, our thinking, our mind, our emotions, our feelings, and our volition, our will. And the door to the flesh and the door to the Spirit is always manipulated or controlled by the volitional part of us. That's the hinge, people. Our wills are deeply, deeply involved. We must want to be coupled to the locomotive, and we must want to be abide in the vine, which also means that we are willing to take on the necessary step of allowing God to couple us up or allowing God to prune us as He needs to. There are some things we can do to keep ourselves attached to the flow of God's power. But before we ask how to walk in the Spirit, let's ask the second more crucial question. Why is it crucial to walk by the Spirit? Why can't I just go ahead? I'm a good person. I have a strong work ethic. I got a good will. I've turned over leaf after leaf. I've stopped, some bad habits. Why is it crucial that I walk by the Spirit? Well, this text gives us two reasons. One in verse 16 and one in verse 18. In verse 16, the incentive for walking by the Spirit is that when you do this, you're not going to gratify the desires of the flesh. He says, but I say, walk by the Spirit, and you'll not carry out the desires of the flesh. So the first reason we should walk by the Spirit is that when we do, the desires of the flesh are overcome. Now, wouldn't you like that? I mean, isn't that one of the things that we struggle with the most? Is those fleshly, selfly desires that always get in the way? Isn't that what Paul's talking about in Romans 7, where he says, listen, when I don't want to do the right thing, that the thing that I know that is right to do, I find that I end up doing the thing I don't want to do. And by doing the thing that I don't want to do, I'm really saying that that thing's good when I know it's bad. So why do I have this problem? Oh, I understand, it's not me, but sin that dwells in me. And on he goes with this discussion. Have you ever felt like that? Well, I'm never going to do that again. Only to find you end up doing that again, and again, and again, and again, and again. And it's like, every time I do it, that thing I don't want to do, I'm almost saying, well, it's going to be good if I'm doing it. But then I know that that's not right. Spiritual schizophrenia. And we say, why? Why can't I overcome this? Well, the incentive for walking by the Spirit is that when you do this, you no longer gratify the desires of the flesh. How to overcome this? Oh, Paul puts it in Romans 7 this way. He says, who can deliver me from this body of death? Oh, I know, through Jesus Christ. He's really saying the same thing here. So the first reason we should walk by the Spirit is that when we do, we overcome the flesh, or He does in us. in recent lessons, I've tried to define the flesh as Paul uses it. And most of the time, though not always, it doesn't simply refer to the physical part of you. You know that. Paul doesn't regard the body as evil in itself. The flesh, that ego which feels an emptiness and uses resources of its own power to try and fill it. The flesh is the big I who tries to satisfy me with anything but God's mercy, His grace, His love. The flesh is that old nature that exerts its will and power over my life or your life. The flesh is that part of us that's in rebellion to God that dies with Christ when we surrender Him in faith. Notice Galatians 5 and verse 24. Now those who belong to Christ Jesus have crucified the flesh with its passions and desires. Now doesn't that remind you of that key verse that Paul gives us back in the second chapter, verse 20? I've been crucified with Christ. It's no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. The life which I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave Himself for me. Do you see the difference? I pray you do. I pray we're not riding this horse for no reason. In Galatians 2:20, flesh is used in its less usual meaning, referring to the ordinary bodily existence. The life I now live in this physical body, this life that I now live, which is not in itself evil. I now live in a fleshly body. Body isn't evil. It's what we do with it. Sometimes can be used for evil purposes. But God intends to use it for His purposes. The important thing to notice is that in Galatians 5:24, the flesh is crucified, and in Galatians 2:20, it is the I, or if you will, that fleshly nature, as in, I am crucified. That fleshly nature is dead. I have been crucified with Christ. As Paul says in Romans 6, that when I came to faith in Christ, I died in Him and I was buried in Him. I'm crucified with Christ. And this new I, this Christ-centered I, with Christ on the throne of the life, now that is that I that lives by faith. The life of, I live in the flesh. I live by the faith. The Son of God who loved me gave Himself for me. The flesh, that old nature, is the ego which feels an emptiness but loathes the idea of satisfying it by faith. That is, by satisfying, by depending on God's mercy in Christ. Instead, the flesh prefers to use the legalistic and licentious resources within its own power to fill its own emptiness. Paul says in Romans 8:7, the mind set on the flesh is hostile to God, does not submit to God's law. The basic mark of the flesh is that it is unsubmissive. It stands up and demands my rights and my way. Doesn't want to submit to God's absolute authority or rely on God's absolute mercy. The flesh says, like the old TV commercial, I'd rather do it myself. Or going down the street singing the Sinatra song, I did it my way. Talking to somebody the other day about an issue with a child. And the child is always saying, you know, I'll do it my way. My comment to that is usually, well, how is that working out for you? My way usually doesn't work out very well. It is not surprising then that in verse 17 it talks about a war that rages between the flesh and God's Spirit. For the flesh sets its desire against the Spirit and the Spirit against the flesh. For these are in opposition to one another, so they may not do the things that you may not do the things that you please. You see, it's a problem at first glance that there is a lively war between the spirit and the flesh within the heart and life of the Christian. And according to verse 17, but according to verse 24, the flesh has been crucified in the Christian. We're going to talk more about that sense in which the flesh is crucified when we get down as far as 24. But for now, let's give Paul the benefit of the doubt and assume that both are somehow true, and the focus on this war within is our flesh versus God's Spirit. God's Spirit conquers our flesh. And because of our time, I probably shouldn't develop this much more than to open up the verse that I want to look at. Look at verse 17 again. We look at God's Spirit conquering our flesh. For the flesh sets its desire against the Spirit, and the Spirit against the flesh. For these are in opposition to one another, so that we may not do the things that you please. The main thing to learn from this verse is that Christians experience this warfare, this struggle within. Now, I don't think any one of us that are here this morning listening to this would deny that fact. I think every one of us have felt the effects of that internal warfare, that struggle that goes on within us. It is not new. It's speaking directly to every one of us. We experience this struggle. If you said to yourself, when I was describing the flesh, well, I have a lot of that still in me, join the club. We all do. Doesn't necessarily mean that we're not Christians. In fact, it may point out to the fact, because we have this struggle, that we are. A Christian is not a person who experiences no bad desires. A Christian is a person who's at war with those very desires by the power of the Spirit of Almighty God. I'm going to stop it there, and we'll come back and pick up on this point tomorrow morning, and we're going to run with it and see where it leads us. Will you join me? Father, I want to thank you so much for the delightful moments that we have together to open your word and allow it to be poured into our lives, and poured into our lives with understanding, giving us ears that truly do hear what the Spirit of God is saying and directing. I thank you, Lord, that any time I open the Word, you seem to want to reach out of it and touch certain areas of my life that you want to deal with. And every day, Lord, is an experience like that, you dealing with my life, chiseling away and cutting away anything that doesn't look like you. And Lord, I confess to you those times when I struggle with that and I fight against the chiseling work of the Spirit of God, the pruning work that needs to be so desperately done in my life. But Lord, what a delightful day it is when just yielding up and allowing you to have your way and your will, so that your life, Lord, can be just flowing through us. God, I pray that we will stay connected, that we will stay coupled to the engine, and that we'll be pulled along by the power and the Spirit of Almighty God. That, Lord, we truly will be led by you, not relying upon our own strength, our own initiative, and our own imagination, but being totally relying upon you. God, give us victory today in that battle that rages within each and every one of us. That, Lord, at every point we will yield to you, Lord, knowing that the victory comes through our submission. Thank you, Father, for the moments you've given us. Now take us out today and use us. Use us as simple instruments that you can work through, Lord, in this world. And may your glory fill our day. To you be honor and praise and glory, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you. Good to see you this morning. I'll be back at 6 tonight as we continue to look at the veil. So join at 6 for prayer and for a mission moment, and we'll see where God will lead us as we look at the veil that was stretched between the holy place and the holy of holies, and what it meant for each of us as that veil was torn. May God bless you. You have a great day. And then we're going to pick right up here on this, seeking to answer this second question further as we get into tomorrow morning. May God bless. I'll see you all later. Have a great, great day.